Turning your Bibles this evening to the Gospel of Luke chapter 12. Well, I hope that many of you have had a great Christmas holiday, and I'd like to thank you for being very gracious to me as well. Very gracious to our church. We're going to receive a report probably not this Sunday, but the Sunday following, the first Sunday in the month, just to give you an idea of how much really we have done through the finances that God has brought through this local assembly. It's an amazing principle to me. I've been to many, many, not fundraisers, but reports where churches would report what they did with their finances, and most of them believe that 10% should go to what we would call outreach ministries. We're up to 35%. That means one-third of the income that we take in this local assembly goes for others. And that's just an amazing principle, as you can clap if you want. It's Tuesday. That's just an amazing principle when you think about the fact that one-third of your money is going for others and not just for here, which it should go to, and for those who work here. But one-third, 33% or 35%, that's an amazing figure. We'll hear more of that in the first week in January. All right, let's take a moment of silent prayer as we normally do to give us the opportunity to enter into self-examination, naming and citing any known sin if we have any. And also, if there's something that might be disturbing or distracting to you, now's not the time to concentrate on any of your problems, but now's the time to give your undivided attention to the Word of God as it is being spoken. That demands that you are filled with the Spirit, so a moment of silent prayer is a time for you to enter into self-examination. With that in mind, let us pray. Father, once again, thank you for the privilege you've given us to gather together with members of the royal family of God, with those who are consistent in the intake of Bible doctrine. For you have said over and over again throughout your word that man must not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of your mouth, the mouth of God. And as we take in physical food on a daily basis, we realize the importance of taking in this spiritual food as well. So may your blessing be upon this evening's message. In the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, we do pray. Amen. We are on the doctrine of enemyship. We are presently, yes, music. Thank you very much. Boy, I had about 6 or 7 Pentecostal hands go up. Todd, you look good praising the Lord. No, thank you very much. You can hear that? See, I could not hear that. Thank you very much for that, because this would be another one of those messages with background music. Sorry, Todd. I said if you raise your hand, I will not point you out. So I didn't mean to point out the fact. I just wanted you to raise one hand, not to go like this. No, I'm only teasing. Thank you, Todd. Thank you, Rick. Thank you. All right, whatever. We've been studying the doctrine of enemyship, and we are now on our 6th point. Let me go through these points rather quickly. Our first point was our definition. We dealt with that. Our second point was the fact that there's both historical, a personal and historical enemyship. I just want to quickly review so that we can pick up where we left off. The personal enemyship dealt with the enemyship between two brothers, Esau and Jacob. An example of historical enemyship, of course, exists between the Arabs and the Jews. The third point in our doctrine dealt with the importance of understanding angelic enmity, literally led by Satan, who is the god of this world and who ultimately is your enemy. Point 4 dealt with the fact that we noted that demons are also called the enemies of God in 1 Corinthians 15:25, Hebrews 10:13. Point five dealt with the fact that unbelievers are said to be the enemies of God in Romans 5:10 and Colossians 1:21. And the reason why I think point 3, 4, and 5 are very, very important is because of our 6th point, which we have to spend some time on. And these are things, by the way, that you're not going to learn in Bible college. You're going to learn these things as you consistently grow in God's grace and knowledge. But I tell you this because we're going to look at a very controversial subject, whether or not the fallen angels had an opportunity for salvation. I will show you why I believe that they did. So our 6th point deals with the fact that point three, four, and five, the 6th point deals with the fact that both categories of the enemies of God, Satan, point three, the fallen angels, point four, and unbelievers. I say both categories because Satan and the fallen angels fit into the same category, but the unbelievers will be judged and sentenced to the eternal lake of fire. You may not think that this is an important point. I think it's a very important point because it backs up the character and the righteousness of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, as well as the character and the righteousness of God the Father and God the Holy Spirit. If you believe that, if you believe the Bible, then you should be believe, again, what the Bible says about eternity. And the Bible says that the unbeliever is like the fallen angel, Satan and all of the demons. The unbeliever is like the fallen angel in that all fallen angels made a decision in eternity past that cannot be reversed. You cannot reverse your decision once you die. All the fallen angels made a decision in eternity past that cannot be reversed, and they will be consigned to the eternal lake of fire, Matthew 25:41. How do we know that? Well, again, let's look at what the Word of God has to say, and let's compare Scripture with Scripture. Our Lord, first of all, we looked at this last week. Our Lord said in Matthew 10:28, He says, "Do not fear those who can kill the body." Anyone can commit murder. You can take someone's physical life from them. Our Lord said, "Do not fear those who kill the body, but are unable to kill the soul, but rather fear him," a reference to God the Father, "who is able to destroy both soul and body in hell." And again, notice, as I mentioned to you last week, another good point. when you're defending the faith, which you should do in 1 Peter 3:15, notice it doesn't say spirit, soul, and body. It only says, again, it says soul and body, not spirit, because you are not born with a human spirit. You are born again at the moment of faith in Christ, but all the unbeliever has is a soul and a body. He does not have a human spirit because God cannot destroy the human spirit. That is the part of man that lives with God forever and ever. Now look what our Lord said in Luke chapter 12, verse 4. He says, I say to you, and this is another passage, I didn't give it to you last week. One of my tapes are not coming out, so bear with me for a second. All right. George, you're going to have to fix the... Where's George? You're going to have to fix one of these tomorrow. Who's going to do tapes tonight? Go ahead and make sure you get the one on the left and not the one on the right. All right, look at Luke chapter 12, verse 4. I say to you, my friends, do not be afraid of those who kill the body and after that have no more that they can do. In other words, no person can ever take your life from you in the sense of your soul life or your spirit life. The only thing they can take from you is your body. So he says, do not be afraid of those who kill the body, and after that they have no more that they can do. But I warn you whom to fear. This is our Lord speaking. Fear the one, and notice the capital O there, a reference to God. Fear the one who, after he has killed, has authority to cast into hell. Yes, I tell you, fear him. Now, that's important in this point because we're dealing with the fact that all the enemies of God end up in that eternal lake of fire. They end up separated from God forever and ever. Point three, Satan will end up there. Point four, the demons will end up there. Point five, all unbelievers will end up there, including loved ones, family members, peers, etc., friends. They will go there if they do not believe in Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. Now, I want you to go all the way back to Isaiah 14 to look at a word that I think is very important in verse 16 concerning Satan. Isaiah 14, 16. We are told throughout the Bible, here's one passage that teaches this, that Satan and the wicked angels will be cast into what the Old Testament calls Sheol, or what we would say in the English language, hell. And we call that literally here the eternal lake of fire. And they will, by the way, remain fully conscious there. They will know that they had rejected the Savior, and they rejected God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit as well, according to Isaiah 14, 9 through 17. The verse I want you to see is not this is not the normal passage we would note, which would be verses 12 through 14. Isaiah 14, verse 16, it says, those who see you, and this is after Satan will be put in a prison and people will begin to gaze at him and realize what he was like and who he was. Those who see you will gaze at you. They will ponder over you saying, is this the man? Really, we should say, is this the one? Because this is not a man, this is an angel. Is this the one who made the earth tremble, who shook kingdoms? There's only one person who made the earth tremble and shook kingdoms, and that is a reference to Satan. And it's interesting that here the word for man is the Hebrew word isha or ish. We've had this before. Sometimes it refers to man, but here you have to compare scripture with scripture. You have to go with the context. Here, ish refers to a champion, a mighty one, a great one. And that's what it's saying right in verse 16. Those who see him, they will see Satan. Those who see you will gaze at you. They will ponder over you saying, is this the one who made the earth tremble, who shook kingdoms? Is this the so-called champion, the mighty one, the great one? This refers to Satan as the leader of the fallen angels in the kingdom of darkness. And that's why I said last week that many subjects that are not directly addressed addressed in the Word of God can be assumed as to be truth, because the subject, if you fall back on that subject with the character, the nature of God, you can actually have questions answered. For example, and this is the main question, and I'm going to give you a lot of chapters and verses on this if you are patient with me, but one question that a lot of individuals have who understand the angelic conflict and understand that God is just and he is righteous, this question that the question that they have is that, did one third of the angels fall, or did they all fall and two thirds came back to Christ? My personal opinion, I answered some of these questions on Fire Talk on Friday night. My personal opinion is that all of them fell. Did one third of the angels fall, or did they all fall and two thirds came back to Christ? I think that's a question that Satan would actually promote to try to make us think that God is not just and righteous. Remember, we saw last week that the elect angels are said to be elect or chosen in 1 Timothy 5:21. Paul said, "I solemnly charge you in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus and of his chosen angels." Here's the key right there. His chosen angels. And the question that you should have is, what were the angels chosen to? And even though the information we have concerning the prehistoric angelic past is very vague, there are certain passages and principles of doctrine that give us insight as to what may have transpired in eternity past. Something transpired in eternity past that we can actually assume according to comparing scripture with scripture. So under point six, in the fact that both categories of the enemies of God, fallen angels and unbelievers, will be judged in the lake of fire, we need to note the reason why. Remember that when God created the universe, and we saw that on Sunday morning, the very fact that that little baby that we celebrated his birth on Sunday morning was the one who formed the creations of the heavens and the earth. When God created the universe, he formed a super race of creatures before, members of the human race, and those super race of creatures we call angels. They are rational beings. They have the ability to make their own decisions, and God made them like he made members of the human race. God made the angels perfect without sin, and God made the angels perfect without sin, acceptable to his absolute righteousness. Now you say, well, if God made the angels perfect without sin, then how come they sinned? For the same reason that we sin, because God, when he makes his creatures perfect, also gives them choice, freedom of choice. So God made the angels perfect without sin, acceptable to his absolute righteousness, but God also did something else. God gave the angels free will so that they could understand his character and worship him. God, again, does not want anyone to worship him because they are forced to. He wants those angels and those creatures, whether they're a member of the angelic race or the human race, he wants them to worship him because they desire to. And the most exalted of all the angels, of course, is found in verse 12. We call him Satan or the devil. He was the anointed cherub in Ezekiel chapter 28. I also gave you that word for Halel, translated the star of the morning. And in Isaiah 14, 12, he was entrusted with responsibilities, granted privileges beyond any other angel, and he abused that freedom or those privileges through his arrogance and his rebellion against God. What was it that caused him to rebel against God? One sin, the sin of arrogance. Arrogance was the self-deception that caused that magnificent creature called Halel in verse 12, or Lucifer, if you will, that's the English or Latin translation, to compete with God rather than to love and worship God. By the way, just as arrogance is the reason for the horrible future of every single member of the human race who rejects the plan of God. So if we compare scripture with scripture, it leads us to certain conclusions. For example, I want you to leave Isaiah for a moment and go all the way to the book of Revelation. I want to show you some of the principles that are found throughout the book of Revelation and throughout the Word of God. Revelation, let's begin with chapter 16. Revelation chapter 16. (Clears throat) Now, we call him Satan the devil, we call Lucifer the devil, or we call Hillel the devil, we call him Lucifer, etc. But if we compare Scripture with Scripture, we find out that there's a problem. There's a problem with the fact that this angel did something that was against the plan of God. He's called the devil and he's called Satan because of one reason. Not because that's his name, but because God sentenced Hillel, that's the closest thing as I mentioned last Thursday or Friday, or Lucifer and all the fallen angels to the eternal lake of fire, Matthew 25, verse 41. In fact, further biblical evidence for the prehistoric angelic conflict and the fact that there was a problem and a difficulty comes from the fact that his name is not the devil. His name is not Satan. That is not his name. That is his title. We study that in the doctrine of the angelic conflict. And remember, these things for some of you may be repetitious, but for many individuals, they have never heard this before. He is called the devil and Satan because that's not his name. Those are titles. And he's called the devil and Satan because of the fact that he was the defense attorney who represented himself and all the fallen angels at that prehistoric trial. We study that in Job 1:6, chapter 1, verses 6 through 12, chapter 2, verses 1 through 5, Zechariah 3, 1 through 2. We have a lot of information on this, so if you're listening right now or in face-to-face teaching and you've never heard about these principles, trust me, we have them in detail. Now, that is not his name. That's not the devil. That's not Hillel's name. That's not the devil's name. The devil and Satan have to do with his title. Someone who is rebelling against God and trying to get many members of the human race to join in his rebellion. Because if you do, then you become an enemy of God. And then he can say, how can a loving God cast all of his creatures into the lake of fire? Something that he desires to do to attack the character and the nature of God. But we are told in Matthew chapter 25 and verse 41, our Lord says, then he will also say to those on his left, depart from me, accursed ones, into that eternal fire. Notice the phrase, eternal fire, which has been, past tense, really it's an aorist tense, but it refers to the past, has been prepared for the devil and his angels. Notice that eternal fire already has been prepared, because that's where all of God's enemies will end up, including every member of the human race. Eternal fire has been prepared for the devil and his angels because the sentence was not immediately executed in our day and age and will not be carried out until the end of human history. In Revelation 20, verse 10, we now infer that Satan appealed the sentence. He's trying to drag down as many members of the human race that he can so that they can become enemies of God. Now, that elapse of time between Satan's sentence, Matthew 25, 41, and his execution indicates, the execution takes place at the end of human history, indicates that human history has to do with that appeal trial of Satan. What is Satan's appeal argument? What would you do if you were against God? Well, you have to attack God's decisions. What case could he possibly construct to reverse the verdict that a perfect, omniscient, just, and righteous God gave? And of course, perhaps we could speculate from a common objection that is frequently repeated in the devil's world. In fact, last night I was doing that thing I told you not to do. I was watching Christian television, and as I was watching Christian television, there was like a huge presentation, great church, all kinds of celebrities were there, and it was probably one of the greatest experiences anyone could ever have when it comes to a Christmas Eve service. And I mean, there were celebrities, there were birds flying around, there were doves, there were trees, there were lights, there were all kinds of people who were popular, and yet the church was promoting the fact that if God is a God of love, there's no such thing as a God of love casting his creatures into the lake of fire. God's enemies will be cast into the lake of fire, says point six. God's enemies are unbelievers in this doctrine, says point five. And Satan's appeal probably followed along the line of what you see in our day and age. Individual, and I'm not just talking about cults, I'm talking about Christians who say, how can a loving God cast his creatures into hell or the eternal lake of fire? I would like to say to them, how can a loving God put his son upon the cross and let him go through all that suffering? I would like to say also to them, if all that was required is the fact that Jesus Christ would go to the cross and pay the price for the sins of the entire world, how could a loving God allow him to be beaten before he got to the cross? How could a loving God allow him to have people mistreat him and punch him in the face and go through all kinds of physical abuse? How could a loving God do that? I don't know how a loving God could do all of that, but I know that I have a God who is just and righteous, and when I get to heaven, I'll ask him exactly why he did that which he did, or I will be humble enough to say, could you please, in your time, explain to me why the Lord Jesus Christ had to go through all of that? But all I know is that I have a God who is just and righteous. I have a God who is a God of love, who has omniscience, who has omnipotence, all power. He's everywhere present. And how can a loving God cast his creatures into hell or the eternal lake of fire? Well, how could he do that to his son? There's parts of the justice and the righteousness of God that we have no idea about whatsoever. But if we just keep on trusting and relying upon him, human history will give us the answer how a loving God can do with that which he desires to do. And in the end, we will just operate in faith toward that which he has done. But by the way, remember Hebrews 11:6, without faith, it is impossible to please God. So if you are the type of person that needs to have all the answers, then apparently you're not the type of person that can operate in faith. We are to walk by means of faith and not by means of sight. So again, human history actually answers this question. It's going to answer this question, how a loving God can cast his creatures into hell or the eternal lake of fire. Human history will answer that question with individuals who have glorified God. And when Satan appealed this particular sentence, what happened in eternity past is that God convened an appeal trial, which is what we call being coterminous with human history. That's what human history is all about. Man was created, you were created to resolve this great angelic conflict and become a part of the trial that God convened billions, or perhaps billions and billions and billions of years ago. And human history is going to show us something. It is going to show us something about the angels. For example, I love this. You're in Revelation chapter, did I give you chapter 16 yet? Or 15? 16. Okay, you're in Revelation chapter 16. I just want you to look at a few of these principles that are actually brought out in the book of Revelation about the angels. And why is it that these angels are worshiping the Lord Jesus Christ? In fact, Revelation 16 brings it out. Revelation 15 brings it out. I think I lost my paper here for a second, but bear with me. Revelation 16, verse 5. I want you to look at it. That's the verse. I heard the angels of the waters saying, righteous art thou. Notice that. Righteous art thou. Who's that a reference to? The Lord Jesus Christ. Who art? You existed before. Who was? You actually existed on planet Earth. The Holy One, because thou didst judge all things, or thou didst judge these things. Notice what Jesus Christ is called. This is very important, as I prove to you why I believe that he is the only one is holy. Notice that Jesus Christ is called the Holy One, not a part of the Holy Ones, but the Holy One. He is the Holy One, and the Holy One can only refer to the fact that he alone is the one who remains experientially holy. And by the way, notice in this particular context, I heard the angel of the waters saying, notice that an angel is speaking. That's an elect angel. And notice that the angel of the waters is saying, righteous art thou who art and who was the Holy One, because thou didst judge these things. If Jesus Christ is called the Holy One, and by the way, this can only refer to the fact that he alone is the one who remains experientially holy, and the elect angels are called holy, how can this be true unless they were made holy? If they were found to be unholy, how can it be true that these angels in Revelation 16:5 are calling Jesus Christ the only Holy One? Well, I'll give you some more passages in just a moment. He's called the only Holy One because he's the only one that ever remained holy. All throughout the Word of God, we have passage after passage that tells us about the problems with the angels, the problems with members of the human race, the problems with even the elect angels at times who had problems saying to Satan, "The Lord rebuke you." That's what Michael did. All through the Word of God, we have angel after angel saying that Jesus Christ is the Holy One. Look at Revelation 7. Look at verses 10 through 12. Go back to chapter 7. I want you to see that resurrected believers are praising the Lord for salvation, and angels join in by twice saying, "Amen." They concur. Amen means they concur. They agree. They express. They believe. What is it that they believe? Well, look at verse 10. Revelation 7, verse 10, and they cry out. This is a reference to salvation. Notice they say amen concerning salvation because they personally understand salvation as well. Revelation 7, verse 10, they cry out with a loud voice saying, "Salvation to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." Now look at verse 11. And all the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, "Amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Who's saying that? Angels are. Why are angels saying that? Because there's only one creature who ever remained holy, and that, of course, is the Lord Jesus Christ. Go back to chapter 5 for a moment in the book of Revelation. I'm setting you up for something, as you're going to see, that I love, because if you believe that there was no angelic salvation or no reward for believing the Messiah, I want you to see what the Bible has to say. In the tribulation period, Revelation 5:2, while angels bring divine judgment upon the earth, no angel is allowed to execute the judgment apart from Jesus Christ. Why? He alone is worthy. Revelation 5, 2 through 5. I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice. Now notice, this is a strong angel. What kind of angel is this? A strong angel. Is he a good angel or a bad angel? Well, he has to be an elect angel. He has to be a chosen angel. He has to be an angel that God is using to bring forth his message. And what does this angel say? This angel says, "Who is worthy to open the book and to break its seals?" And the other 2/3 billion angels said, "One of us are." No. Why? None of them were. Look at verse 3. No one and no one in heaven. And by the way, notice it says no one in heaven or on the earth or under the earth was able to open the book or to look into it. And John says, "I began to weep greatly because no one was found worthy." What about Gabriel? Wasn't he worthy? Didn't he keep himself without sin? What about Michael the archangel? Wasn't he worthy? Didn't he keep himself without sin? No angel kept themselves without sin. No one in heaven or on the earth or under the earth was able to open the book or to look into it. And John says, "I began to weep greatly because no one was found worthy to open the book or to look into it. And one of the elders said to me, 'Stop weeping.'" And we study this in the doctrine of weeping, by the way. I use this passage. "Stop weeping. Behold, the lion that is from the tribe of Judah, the root of David, has overcome, so as to open the book and its seven seals." To open the book and its what? Seven seals. Why? There was only one in heaven worthy to open the book. Who was it? A member of the human race. All angels fell. And that's why all angels looked, and I'll give you some chapters and verses on this before we leave, but they looked forward to the cross. Go back for a moment to the book of Job, chapter 4. Go way back to Job 4, verse 17. In Job 4, verse 17, we find the statement that God charges error against his angels. And this is used, by the way, this is used to argue, Job uses this, and well, even his friends use this in a little while later on, to argue that no person could ever be just before God. Look at Job chapter 4, verse 17. It says, can mankind, I'll wait for you to get there before the book of Psalms, Job 4, 17, can mankind be just before God? Notice that. It says, can mankind be just before God? Can a man be pure before his maker? Look at this. He puts no trust even in his servants and against one-third of his angels? No. Against two-thirds of his angels? No. Against his angels, he charges error. Only one member of the human race was ever perfect. Only one member of the angelic only one member of the human race ever paid the price for the sins of those who were angels. I don't know how Christ did that, but all I know, if you look at Colossians 1, 20 and 21, when he died, he reconciled individuals who were in heaven because they were trusting not in the fact that Jesus would become an angel, although I could give you this principle that could make it more confusing, that he is called the angel of the Lord when he appears in the Old Testament. But the fact of the matter is the cross is the center of the universe. And if you don't understand that there's only one person who is the God-man and the center of the universe, you will not understand why it is that both angels, fallen angels, and members of the human race go into the eternal lake of fire. So let's go back to this principle again. When Satan appealed his sentence, God convened an appeal trial, which was coterminous with human history. We are living in human history right now. Did the fallen angels have an opportunity to become born again and saved? Well, if you believe that the character and the nature of God is just and righteous and pure, and that he gave them an opportunity to repent and come back to him, then you are believing what I believe. You can disagree with me as if you want to. But I would challenge you to give me chapter and verse and show me in the Bible where there's any other creature that has come from the hand of God that is holy, righteous, and just. Now, I like this because that's why we have been created to resolve the angelic conflict. Remember, before God created man, God knew all about you billions and billions of years ago. He anticipated everything about you. He anticipated your mental attitude sins, your sins of the tongue, your overt sins. Billions and billions of years ago, God anticipated man's fall. And then in his matchless grace, I love this because it reminds me of Christmas when we think about the little baby Jesus. God, in his matchless grace, designed a plan of salvation for who? For all mankind through faith in Jesus Christ. That, by the way, is not something that an unfair, unjust, and unloving God would do. Now, you think about it. How many people do you know right now in our day and age? In fact, I shared this in the past week or so with some people who believe they believe in the limited atonement. Christ didn't die for everyone. Well, if he didn't die for everyone, and you and I were born in sin, you've heard this argument many times, but it bears repeating. If Jesus Christ did not die for every single member of the human race, only for those whom God has chosen, and then all other members of the human race are cast into the lake of fire, that's not grace. That's not fair. That's not just, because if that were true and I'm not elected, I'd stand before God and I would say, well, if you created me and gave me life, then put me in the Garden of Eden and let me see if I can keep myself pure or holy before you cast me into the lake of fire. And of course, I would say that because it's the only appeal I could give. But in reality, we know that eventually all of us would fall. But God anticipated man's fall. He anticipated your fall. And in his matchless grace, he designed a plan of salvation. Notice I said salvation for who? For all mankind. How? One way. through faith in Jesus Christ. But not only that, and by the way, that's why salvation has to be faith alone in Christ alone, nothing added to it. Not only did God say, okay, Bob, Joe, Mary, Alice, I'll give you the opportunity to be saved, but God did something else that's fantastic. God created fabulous assets, fabulous privileges, fabulous opportunities for who? Every believer, so that that believer might enjoy fellowship with God. God's grace is freely available to every member of the human race for salvation, and every member of the human race who wants to have the highest and best that God has designed for their life after salvation. But, now listen to me carefully, because here's where I'm going with this. Every member of the human race doesn't take advantage of this. They complain. They murmur. They come up with a reason as to why they should refuse to believe in Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, or why they should refuse not to follow God. But point six in our doctrine says, all creatures who rebel against God will live forever and ever in a place of fire and torment. They'll live in a place that is going to be totally separated from God forever and ever and ever. They will suffer eternal damnation. They will have all kinds of pains, all kinds of sorrows, as in Isaiah chapter 14. They will suffer a bad memory. Their conscience will be defiled. The worm does not die. That's where they will end up. And are you going to turn around and say, well, that's a God that's unfair and unjust, like Satan would have us say? Are you going to say, well, you know what? I love my unbelieving relative or my friend who is an unbeliever, and I don't think that this is fair. Well, go back to the cross. Why is it that the cross is the center of the universe? If you don't think that it is fair, then why did the Lord Jesus Christ die for the sins of the whole world? Why did God the Father cause his Son to suffer? All enemies end up rejected by God and in a place of sorrow and pain and suffering forever and ever. And if you say that is unfair, I would say to you in Romans chapter 9, who are you to even answer against God? We've seen that many times in Romans 9. Who art thou, old man, who says to the potter, you should not have made me thus? Think about how arrogant we are to even question the character and the nature of God. And even though many of you may have been impressed with people that you love who have shared their gratitude and thankfulness to you in the past season through Thanksgiving or Christmas. Remember, there is no one that loves you more than God. There is no one who will stick by you more than God. He's your best friend. He's the one that will be faithful to you. He's the one that wants you to understand that creatures who have a free will have an eternal destiny that even he does not want them to have. But he gave them a free will. And his enemies, Satan, and the fallen angels and all unbelievers go to the lake of fire, not for any other reason except for one sin. This is the sin, according to the Bible. No one goes to the eternal lake of fire or hell, but by their own negative volition. That's John 3, 18 and 36. Go there for a second. I want to build line upon line and let you see this. We have about 10 minutes, but I want you to bear with me because this is a question we have over and over again. How can a loving God do this? Well, how can someone who is grateful say, I want nothing to do with you? Think about that. You know, maybe Christmas season is a time to bring out this illustration. I hope that I'm not getting, I hope I'm not hurting any of you, but have any of you done so much for people? I mean, you did like so much for members of the human race. You went out of your way to help them out, get them out of jams. You were always there. You were their best friend. When everyone turned their back, you were there. And you saw them express their gratitude toward individuals who hate them and took advantage of them, and when it came for them to express their gratitude toward you, they were too busy paying the bills for those who had screwed them all year long. You can laugh at that, but think about the fact that we have Christians who live in the cosmic system. They live in the devil's world, but they had no time for God. And yet the one who loved them the most, the one who gave them the most, the one who honored them the most, the one who was always there, the one who never turned their back on them is the one that received no attention. I was talking to someone recently, I won't say when, and I was talking about the fact, you know what's really gross about life? I really learned this lesson the past 2 or 3 years. You know what's something that is really gross about life? Maybe some of you have learned this lesson. Paul said it in 2 Corinthians 12:15. The more you do for people, the more they hate you. The less you do for them, the more they love you. I mean, you can, and I don't say they love you. I'm just saying that the people that you treat the best are usually the ones who treat you the worst. And if you really want to have a good Christmas with a lot of presents, pick out 50 people in your life, and from Thanksgiving to Christmas, treat them like Scooballer. Your tree's going to be filled. It seems like the worse you treat people, the more they want to give for you. And I was thinking about that today. In fact, I was praying about that. And something came to my mind about the fact that those are the people that you put on works programs. You see, once a person knows that you really don't like them, then they get on a work program to try to get your love and get your friendship and get you to feel good about them. But the people that love you the most, and they know that you love them, well, you're there. You're always going to be there. You're always going to be there. The sad thing is you're not, and someday they'll wake up and realize that they lost the best thing they ever had. I think we could have some amens, not vocally. Oh, we had some vocally, but I think some of you can identify exactly what I'm trying to say. And that's very sad, because if you really love someone, you want to treat them like a king and or a queen, and then all of a sudden you find out that the feeling's not mutual. And if you ever feel bad and condemned, just think about the fact that God so loved the world that he gave his uniquely born son. He gave the best that he had to offer. And yet, not forget about the unbelievers. Even in Christianity, people don't have the integrity or virtue and character to express that gratitude. No one goes to hell. No one goes to the eternal lake of fire or hell, but by their own negative volition. You've heard this before, but this is a part of my doctrine to show you why the angels are in hell, or else God is unfair. God has double standards. God is unjust. Look at John 3:18. He who believes in him, the Lord Jesus Christ, is not judged. He who does not believe has been judged already. Why? Because they have fallen like Satan did one time. Because iniquity was found in Satan's heart in Ezekiel 28. No. He who believes in him is not judged. He who does not believe has been judged already. Why? Because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. If God gave members of the human race that solution to their problem of sin and didn't give it to the angels, God would be unfair and unjust for not giving them a second chance or a third chance or a fourth chance like he has given us. Look at in even more. Infinity. Look at verse 36. He who believes in the Son has eternal life, but he who does not obey the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abides in him. Notice we have nothing mentioned there about sin or failure. We have one word mentioned, believe. John 3:18, he who believes in him is not judged. He who does not believe has been judged already, because why? He has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. John 3:36, he who believes in the Son has eternal life. He who does not obey the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abides in him. Let me give you two passages as I close, because I can only give you so much in these principles. I know maybe some of you know them, but the majority do not. Go to Colossians 1, and then we'll close with Philippians 2, and then I'll let you go. Colossians 1. And I'm not trying to, I'm not trying to be someone who's causing problems when it comes to what people think, whether angels were saved or whether they had the opportunity to be saved or not. I'm trying to educate you so that you can be trained in defending the character, the nature, the justice, and the righteousness of God. Because there are doctrinal individuals who are great doctrinal teachers, great Bible teachers, who say that angels did not have that second opportunity. Look at Colossians 1:15. I read this on Sunday morning. He, Jesus Christ, is the image of the invisible God. Actually, the Greek says the exact image, the firstborn of all creation. For by him, Jesus Christ, little baby Jesus, all things were created, both in the heavens and on the earth, visible and invisible. Whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities or all things have been created by him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is also the head of the body, the church, and he is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that he himself might come to have first place in everything. For it was the Father's good pleasure for all the fullness to dwell in him. But here's the verse I love. Through him to reconcile all things to himself. I dealt with this on Friday evening. Most of you were not here with our question and answer period with Fire Talk, but I have to do it. I want it on tape. And through him to reconcile all things to himself, having made peace, verse 20, through the blood of his cross, how? Through him, I say, whether things on earth or things in heaven, whether things on earth or things in heaven, what was in heaven that needed to be reconciled? Angels. Now, the only thing you can say if you have any knowledge of the Word of God is to say, well, Enoch and Elijah were there because they did not die. But if you're trying to defend the fact that God was unfair to the angels, that's a stupid thing to say. But if you want to say that, that's fine. I'll say, yes, that could be true, but I'll bet you every penny you have that that's not. But then that doesn't matter because I'm not going to win till I get to heaven, so therefore your pennies don't matter. Look at Philippians chapter 2, my final passage. I love this because it brings glory to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, to the plan of God the Father, the revelation of God the Holy Spirit. Philippians chapter 2. We study this in our series, but I love verse 9 again. Therefore also God highly exalted him, bestowed on him, Jesus Christ, the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every, George, come on up here now, get ready to close with the song. Pick one out good. I want you to see that. I love this. Look at it, verse 10. See, I see these things as I'm teaching, like, more clearer than even when I'm studying. But look at verse 10. At the name of Jesus, it says, every. Who should bow? Every. Repeat that. Every. That's not loud enough. Every. There you go. At the name of Jesus, every knee should bow. How many knees? Every. Every knee should bow. Of those who are where? In heaven. Now, why should I bow to Jesus Christ if I'm an angel and I've kept myself up here for billions and billions and billions of years? All he did was to keep himself pure for 30 years. And God didn't ask me to die for the sins of the entire world. Why should I bow to him? I should bow to him because he's the only one that is worthy to be bowed to. Therefore, there must have been, watch me, not George, he's just preparing a bow song for you. Therefore, there's only one person worthy to be worshipped. Who is it? The Lord Jesus Christ. Look at verse 9. God also, again, therefore also God highly exalted him, bestowed on him the name which is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of those who are in heaven. And by the way, those who are in heaven at that time were not members of the human race. And on earth, those are believers and unbelievers that are alive. And under the earth, well, those are fallen angels. Those are the fallen creatures and even Old Testament saints. And that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. You may not think that it's important to prove that all categories of enemies of God go to the eternal lake of fire because all categories of the enemies of God have refused God's invitation. But I believe that. And that's why I believe that every member of the human race, every member of the angelic race, all fell. And when they fell, they came to a point in the eternal state. They're going to come to that point. They came to a point in the eternal state. They'll come to the point in time. Some of them did. But in the eternal state, Every knee shall bow. It doesn't matter who they are. Why, there's only one person that is righteous. All the enemies of God will be cast into the eternal lake of fire. And that includes the unbeliever, that includes the fallen angels, and it's because of one reason and one reason only. They did not believe and trust and rely on the only one that is worthy to be praised. Let's bow our heads right now. Father, we pray, and I pray as a pastor that you would guide and direct me to explain these principles of doctrine and these truths, to do one thing and one thing only, to bring to our memory that the only one that is worthy to be praised is the one that we are truly here for. For you have reconciled all things to yourself through him on that cross, whether they're on earth, under the earth, or in heaven. Thank you for your son, Jesus Christ, and thank you for a reminder of the true meaning of this season, which is to bring glory to him with all our heart and soul. And so, Father, thank you for this opportunity to study more about your son. May your blessing be in the closing moments of our service. We pray these things in Christ's name. Amen.